Welcome. Well, this time we'll call the July meeting of the Murfreesboro Parks and Recreation Commission to order. Always we'll start with the prayer and pledge of allegiance, and Dr. Linda Gilbert is going to lead us in that. Linda?
All right. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the privilege of coming here today. We thank you for the beautiful world that you created and that you allow us to take care of. Help us indeed to take care of your world. We thank you for the children and the families of Murfreesboro. We thank you that you have given us the privilege to try to serve them. We thank you that you do call us together to do your work in this world. And now may everything we do say and think be for your praise and your glory and not that of our own. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Linda.
Absolutely.
Everybody should have received their packet earlier this week via regular delivery or email. And the packet was the minutes from the May meeting. This time we'll entertain any changes or corrections, and if there are none, a motion for approval. Is there a motion?
If there's no questions or comments, I move for approval.
Thank you, Eddie.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved. Thank you, Mitzi. Lanny, I believe we've got an introduction to make today for our program coordinator at the Bradley Academy Museum.
Mr. Chair, we do, and members of the commission, it's always a pleasure to introduce new staff. And, of course, last year, if you recall, we took over the Bradley Academy Museum. We've been moving forward introducing new things into the museum, and fortunate now to have a new coordinator, Vonchelle Stembridge, who is in the audience, who I'll ask to come to the podium, is a graduate of Middle Tennessee State University. She majored in child development and family studies. My understanding is Vonchelle's grandparents actually went to Bradley Academy, so she has a real distinct tie there. And Vonchelle has worked for us really for the past 8 years, working, started at the Wilderness Station and moved to Patterson, been involved with the children's programs, I think actually worked for the city schools through ESP, and just a wonderful person, a lot of energy and a lot of history, and we just sent her on a kind of a whirlwind tour to two different museums, and she may even want to say something about that, but she's hit the ground running, and we're looking for great things out of Vonchelle. So, Vonchelle, would you like to say something to the commission?
I would like to say thank you for this opportunity. I look forward to working with each individual and the Parks and Rec, and thank you for this opportunity.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
We're glad to have you.
Thank
you. We'll move now into new business. First item is a consideration of the Acorn Festival.
Hey. Today I'm going to talk about a new special event called Acorn Festival that we're seeking approval for. This morning, I was reading an article in Southern Living Magazine that named Murfreesboro one of the top 20 college towns to live in the South. It cited our strong and growing music culture as the reason for that. And because of our strong and growing music culture, we think this is the perfect time to introduce a new music festival to Murfreesboro. We want to start in November a one-day music festival called Acorn Festival. We want to partner with Oakland's Historic House and Museum to put this on at Oakland's in the multi-purpose event space out in the field. And we are seeking to make this a folk and indie rock music festival focusing on some awesome bands. The Acorns Fall, from September to November. So we want to host this in November when our park is just littered with acorns and they're everywhere and you can't get away from them. We have, this is our logo for Acorn Festival. And we currently have 4 bands lined up that have agreed, pending your approval, to perform at the festival. They are Rye Baby, Boy Named Banjo, The Hardened Draw, and Frontier Ruckus. Our headliner would be Frontier Ruckus, and they have around 15,000 likes on Facebook. Their music videos on YouTube get around 150,000 views. So we really think that this is going to draw a big crowd. All of our bands are going to draw a really big crowd out to Oakland to use that great multi-purpose space. We want the admission for Acorn Festival to be $10 per person. That would get you a wristband to get through the gates. And our funds for the talent and any resale items and the event supplies have already been allocated in our new fiscal year budget. And we would be taking care of the managing of the event and the booking of the bands and all of that portion. And then Oakland's would be hosting us and overseeing the vendors. So that is a little overview of an exciting new special event that we have been working on and that we are seeking your approval for.
Okay. Thanks, Pam. Any questions?
Pam, I see the admission is $10 per person. Any discussion or thoughts for a reduced rate for children, or is this bands that my preteen and teens probably wouldn't be? I mean, what's...
Yeah, we think that youth and adults, young adults, that this will be, these bands have like a wide range of not only being appropriate for those ages, but being enjoyed by all ages. But we want to have ages 5 and under be free. So 6 and up would be the $10 wristband.
Any idea on number of people?
What was it that we said last?
Or best guess?
We're hoping to get around like 900 is what I'm hoping, since it would be the first time we're doing it. But we, taking that $10, we could kind of cover our bases with around 400 to 500.
Mm-hmm. On a Saturday, I guess?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
How securable is the area that you're talking about? I mean, are you going in with temporary fencing, or are you going in with...
As part of the plan, Councilman Smotherman, we've talked with Murfreesboro Police Department, and they're going to be out there in full force that day. I think they might even do some community awareness about their new police headquarters that's going to be across the street. We will be bringing in some temporary fencing so we can establish the gates. I guess the east side of the property does have fencing, so wherever it doesn't have fencing, since it is a paid event, we'll have temporary fencing put up. And then parking will be in the front lawn at Oakland's on our property. Originally, our plan, we had gotten approval to park at the police headquarters, but with things progressing with that building, we had to change plans, so we park on the grass.
Nate, I know you've got a lot of experience with Uncle Dave Making Days and musical type events. I know we've already asked the question about children. Will there be any kind of consideration made for seniors? I'm probably telling something about my age now, but will there be a consideration made for seniors?
Right now, we're not. We're just doing the children ages 5 and under for free. We want to make it a very affordable, you know, event. I know a family of, like mine, a 6-year-old and a 3-year-old, it'd be hard to pay $10 for everybody. But for right now, this is kind of the first year we're going to start and see what kind of draw we think we'll have. I think we'll easily exceed 500. I think we'll be closer to 1,000 people there, considering the talent of the bands that we have coming in.
Any other questions?
You talked about this being, hoping to make this an ongoing event. Will this be similar in the sense, I looked at the MTSU football schedule, and I'm mapping out my calendar, and one of the first things I look at is, do we have a conflict with a football game? Is that a consideration going forward? Are you going to try to set a third Saturday in November, or is it going to be something that will be possibly flexible in order to stay away from, or maybe to combine with football home dates?
I think since it's once a year and not like a monthly program, it doesn't have to be always the third Saturday of November. I think we can be flexible in years to come. This was the best date to not conflict with other parks events is why we picked this date in November. But going forward, we're going to keep doing that same consideration of, and it's good. It's a good idea to look at MTSU football as well.
And then I guess the other question is the timeline, how long during the day, I mean, what time will it begin and what time, considering it would end?
Once we confirm bands, we'll have a better confirmed time, but right now it's looking to be that gates would open up around 4 p.m. and the last band would stop playing at 10.
Questions? Any others? There are none. We need a motion for approval of the program.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make that motion.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second? Anyone?
I'll second.
Thank you, Steven. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It is approved. Thank you. It's going to be a good event. It's like pulling teeth today. What's wrong with you guys?
Leave me hanging.
Yeah, leave me hanging, man. I don't know if they didn't like your first or what. I mean,
I feel it's a better job.
All right, we'll move now. Item number two. Allison Davidson's going to tell us about a program, salsa making and salsa dancing. Allison, welcome.
Thank you. Follow up a little bit on Pam's music. I'm sorry, I'm not going to demonstrate the dancing, nor do I have any salsa. I'm real sorry about that. But we're trying to educate the public on how to eat better and how to make some simple things on their own, easy things to make, easy things to grow. A couple of years ago, Jennifer Joins underwent master gardening training at UT Extension. And so I tried to figure out how I could take advantage of that to the best way possible for Parks and Recreation. And over the winter, we started a garden at SportsCom, just a small one. And Jennifer had the idea of creating a salsa garden. And so we've grown tomatoes and peppers and onions, maybe cilantro, I'm not sure about that. But then we also, McFadden Community Center also has a garden as well that the kids work with. So we've kind of combined with them. So we're going to do a joint program with McFadden and with SportsCom. We're actually going to be over at McFadden teaching people how to make salsa, different types of salsa, just kind of how to make simple things on your own with simple ingredients, things that you could purchase on your own or things that you could grow. And just to make it a little bit more fun, because that's the way Jennifer is, she decided she wanted to combine salsa dancing with the salsa making. So you'll go to McFadden, learn how to make salsa, get to taste the salsa. I believe we're even hoping to be able to send you home with some salsa. Then once the salsa's made, recipes are sent out, cards are given out, then we're going to have one of our dance instructors from the department come and lead everybody in some salsa dancing and Latin dancing. So that's going to be in September on the 13th and 14th at McFadden. It's going to be at 6 p.m. on the 13th and 9 a.m. on the 14th. And we're asking $5 because, well, our gardens are small, so we're not going to be able to supply everything with our own garden. So we are going to have to supplement that with some extra ingredients and the jars to send the salsa home with.
All right.
All right.
Any questions for Allison regarding this program? I know the salsa is healthy. It's the two bags of chips that I down with the salsa that's typically the problem.
Everything in moderation, right? And it doesn't count if it's with healthy.
Okay, good. Wow, you can apply that in a lot of areas.
Now you have two dates,
yes.
The Friday and Saturday. Is it you come to one or the other, or is it you come to both?
It's an either or. We did two dates in order to be able to offer more people options. So some people that work will be able to come to the evening one, and some people that don't would be able to come to the morning. So, and that is going to be a pre-register thing, so you would need to contact Jennifer, because obviously we have to have a head count to make sure we have enough supplies.
Any other questions for Allison? There are none. We need a motion for approval of the program.
I move to approve.
Thank you, Tim. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any other discussion? None. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It is approved.
Right, thank you.
Dee, I just told you, I think the glue in here is getting to people.
You might be right, Eddie. I think you might be onto something. I've never seen y'all so quiet. All right, we'll move to item 3. Angela is going to give us an update on Greenway renovations. Angela?
Thank you. Our Greenway first was built in 96, and the Lytle Creek section opened in 97. And so here we are years later with a very well-used and well-loved trail that also requires upkeep and maintenance. Part of our reconstruction renovation projects that are ongoing basically include a prioritized approach. We have started a variety of projects, most in order to replace decking, redo pavement, work on different areas along the way as we go to make sure that the trail stays in good condition. The project that we've been working on for some time, which I'm really glad to bring to you today, and you frequent Greenway users will be very glad to hear, is the replacement of the restrooms at Manson Pike and Thompson Lane trailheads is a priority issue in order to have those in good condition, and it is going to require a total replacement. So the project that we worked together to offer a request for competitive seal bid proposals through Loesen Associates and, of course, the city's purchasing department to make those requests have been received, have been scored, and a proposal from Hunter Knipschild Company was selected for recommendation to replace those. The actual units are 9-foot by 12-foot restroom buildings with waste storage and a vacuum pump ultra-low flush water closet system. The unit price of each is $58,795, total price of $117,590. We will do the removal of the old restrooms and the installation of these through our contract through the city's engineering department with the concrete and stormwater contract, and we'll fund the whole project through our capital allotments that we have been working with for our Greenway reconstruction program. So I welcome any questions about the project.
Any questions for Angela regarding the project?
So 2 9-by-12 restrooms, total $117,000?
Yes, sir.
Gosh, can't you build a small house for that amount?
It is a you could, absolutely. What we did in looking at the price and in looking at the selection of these units, it actually has been a pretty extensive process. We looked at first installing through regular hookups and doing regular flushable units. We were not able to do that because of the rock in the area and the extensive cost of digging in order to make those connections. When we first bid the project, that was the intention, and the project came back at a cost that was more than almost triple this cost. It came back extremely high, something that was out of our budget and what we didn't feel like was a reasonable solution. We looked for several other solutions since then and have landed on this as a cost that, as you mentioned, is absolutely significant. But the replacement of the restrooms and in the units that are available and the longevity of what we expect for the way that they will serve high volumes of people that use the Greenway, this is the recommendation. Yes, sir.
And the other thing I want to add, too, is these have to be built so that they function in a floodplain, because at certain times they may be underwater, especially the one at Thompson Lane. I've seen the one there now with just a rooftop showing. So they're constructed to be in those particular areas. So it takes a special application for those. And then when you make them self-contained, generally speaking, when we build a restroom in parks, it runs about $300 to $400 a square foot just for a normal restroom. You think, gosh, that's really high, but you have to think that there's a lot going on in a really small enclosed space. The plumbing, the electrical, everything that's in there. And if you build houses, you know that the most expensive part of any house is always the restrooms and the kitchens, just because of what goes into them. So we did look at the cost. We looked at different units made by different manufacturers. They're made from the East Coast to the West Coast. There's all kinds of applications for way back deep woods that are chemical type applications to this type of application where it's self-contained. We have to go down and actually pump that out. But that's what we're doing now. We have self-contained units at both of those locations. So we feel the price is pretty much appropriate for what's in the industry.
Any other questions?
Lanny, are these actually constructed inside the floodplain? I mean, I'm assuming with the greenway right next to the river there that
they are.
They're close. So they are, and they are actually designed to be submersible.
It's my understanding, isn't that right?
One of the requirements of the bidding was the certification that met those requirements in terms of floodplain construction and removal. They're actually built off-site, you know, and come entirely constructed. This particular one, there were several options that were available. This particular one has a above-ground unit. As far as the storage tank goes, it does not include things that are buried, which that was one of the reasons why it scored higher. Was you know, just the ease of that and how that interacts in terms of you know, back to the original concern of the rock and the digging, as well as the flooding concerns.
Although I wouldn't recommend using them while they're flooded. Didn't want to be testing them out. I mean, any other questions? If there are none, we need a motion for approval of the project as presented.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and a second. That was quick. Thank you. Any other discussion?
I was getting a little afraid of where the discussion was going, so take care of that
move
really fast.
Along.
Yeah, move it along.
Any other questions? All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
Ed. If I could, Mr. Chair, just to follow up on Mr. Smotherman's question, in the specifications, it says product requested specifications, and it's in bold print. It says the structure must include the NFIP floodproofing certification from the manufacturer, comma, this structure will flood at times. So yeah. That was a requirement.
And certainly we understand the importance of commercial grade equipment. We're not dealing with like residential equipment, so it's hard to compare the apples and oranges to each other. But more than that, for me, it's difficult to understand how you take an electrical switch and you submerge it underwater, and then 2 days later you're using it as a facility, but not at the time of the flood. But the I would assume there are probably some pretty sophisticated types of application that are specialized that wouldn't normally be borne by a person who was just building a house.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Angela.
Thank you.
Lanny, you're going to give us an update on the mountain bike trail planning and design.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. For many years, I know back before we started building the Barfield Crescent Park, we had people that were expressing interest in mountain biking, us developing mountain biking for the ones that were here when we were developing Barfield. That was one of the considerations that we had. We looked at, you know, how could we incorporate mountain biking, biking, hiking on all of those particular areas, and we did in put biking in at first, and we had some accidents. We basically pulled the plug on biking at that point and made it just hiking, and then the Tennessee Trails Association came in and helped us develop all of the wilderness trails. If you've been out there, you know there's 4 to 5 miles of wilderness trails. And so we never really got back in pursuing the biking. Here in the last couple of years, we've had that resurgence of people coming out and asking, you know, can you bring that back and take a look at it again? We recently had a meeting with some folks that were interested. And so we're proposing that we look at it again, that we hire Griggs and Maloney Incorporated. And Ryan Maloney, who is the one that has submitted a proposal to us, is an avid mountain biker. And so with his expertise, I thought it would be appropriate to see if we could get them engaged. And so the proposal offers to develop the goals and objectives of the proposed mountain bike system, define the parameters of the trail use and the areas available to create a trail. And we want to make sure that as we look at creating a trail at Barfield, we respect the other things that are there as well. The environmental impact, looking at it, looking at the existing trails that are there and how we can either incorporate the two or how we can have two different trails that would coexist. The other thing we want them to look at is examine our emergency response access to the trails. And if you've been to Barfield, you know that that is a big facility. It's about 350 acres of wooded area. It's a mile to the back of the park. And we've had some emergencies out there. Generally speaking, what we do is we bring in the fire department, the police department, and the emergency response teams, and we together put a plan together. So if something happens, we know where that would be. So the same thing would happen as we look at this trail. We would look at where are we developing it, where would be our access points, where would be our takeout points if there were accidents, etc. And then we would look at the design of the trail. Of course, there are different levels of mountain bike riders. There's some that are just beginners and some that want 10 miles of trail and switchback, and their normal ride is 10 to 15 miles. So we want to look at, you know, how can we incorporate the largest group of potential riders? And then also looking at if we do something like we do with the Tennessee Trails, what would be the memorandum of understanding between us and other outside organizations, nonprofits, if you would, that could help us maintain the trail and do certain things to promote programs. This would also include creating design documents for the construction of the project and developing a conceptual master plan, which would be one of the first things that we would want to do to engage the community in the development and bringing in people that are interested, bringing it back to the commission so that you have input and you look at it from a standpoint of, is this what we want to do? If it is, you know, what are some of the parameters that we want to set, rules, regulations, et cetera. So the proposal, we think, is a good proposal from Griggs and Maloney. They're proposing to do this in an amount not to exceed $18,500. And we would recommend that the commission give this favorable approval.
Is there any questions of Lanny regarding this project? Excuse me.
Lanny, how much consideration was given to other locations? Because we've already got an established park there, was there any consideration given to maybe the corner of Fortress and Blaze, where we have backwoods territory that will probably follow a river and stuff, or was there any consideration maybe to the Greenway area that we're building at Walter Hill? And the reason is just from the comment you made, I mean, if you've got a Greenway running very close by this, it seems like it would be more logical to build it in an area where you've got easy access in the event of emergency, as opposed to just completely in a wooded area. And I guess I'm a little bit confused from the very beginning of this, because it's called mountain bike trails, and we don't have mountains in Murfreesboro. We got hills maybe, but not mountains.
Right.
But the how much consideration was given to new projects that we're currently looking on and developing, as opposed to going back and putting this into a park that's already existing?
That would be one of the other things that I failed to mention. If I'd read the entire last bullet, says develop a conceptual master plan for future mountain bike trail development along the Greenway and the North Murfreesboro Greenway extension. So we're going to be looking in other areas. That's what we've talked about. Mountain bike is just really kind of a term for a bike with knobby tires. There's a big group. There's a large contingent of folks that ride, and they're having to go either to Nashville or travel 60 miles to different areas. And if we can do something, and we're not going to be the elite trail. I mean, we just don't have enough room to do that. But if we can provide an opportunity, I think, here in Murfreesboro for them to experience, get their children out, get them involved with it, I think that's a good thing. So we'll be looking at other areas as well, but we'll be bringing those proposals to you too.
Good question. Any others?
You talked about when it was first built that we had some initial trail, mountain bike trails, but we had accidents or injuries.
The trail that we had really the is the paved trail,
okay,
that goes back to the campground, and we allowed bikes on it, and people were riding too fast, the corners were too sharp, and we basically said, after several accidents, that's not probably appropriate use for that.
And this one would be much more bike only, because if you're using the pave, that's pedestrian.
And that's part of what we would look at, Mr. Shirley. We'd look at, is there areas that we can share trails, or does it need to be separate from the other trails? There's just a lot of things to consider, but we want to make it good for the hikers as well as the bikers when we do it.
Any other questions? There are none. We need a motion for approval of this design request as presented.
A motion for approval.
Thank you, Stephen. Is there a second?
Second. Go ahead. You can do it this time.
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Is there any other discussion? Being none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It is approved. All right, Lanny and Becky are going to give us a very quick overview of the 2015 annual report.
Yes, I'll start, and I don't want to steal any of Ms. Johnson's thunder. She's done a great job. She assembles these every year and goes out and twists the arms of the staff to get her information. She's smiling because she knows that's true. But it shows several things in here that we're very proud of that we accomplished in 2015. Of course, the renovation of SportsCom is on the front page. Our ribbon cutting at the Adams Tennis Center is on the front page. Those were two great accomplishments. Of course, we took over the Bradley Museum. We won 27 awards at the Tennessee Recreation Parks Annual Conference. That was a record for us. Not sure we're going to break that this year. But the thing that we really want you to look at is the number of people that are participating in the Murfreesboro Parks and Recreation programs. If you add them all together, the user visits exceed 1 million user visits per year. And that's pretty phenomenal in the way of parks and recreation. From financial assistance side, people that apply not only for individuals, the children, all the way through the families, we gave out an estimated $389,632 in financial assistance. So we try to make it to where everybody in Murfreesboro can participate in our program. And as you look through, you'll see a lot of different things. But I'll stop there and turn it over to Ms. Johnson, let her give you some highlights.
All right. I'm just going to highlight some of the sections in the report. Page 3 has a message from Lanny that introduces the report. We have the section on the that highlights our 27 awards that we won this year. There is from pages 10 through 17 that highlights our parks and our facilities. It gives you an idea of the inventory, what we have, an idea of who uses those facilities, and some numbers on the people that participate in those facilities. Then we have a section on all of our use agreements, and we outline them. We have 153 use agreements or partnerships that we do. We do offer 286 in-house programs through our staff a year, and through these partnerships with the other 153 agreements, we are able to offer more additional programming, such as martial arts is one that stands out, where there's a martial arts instructor that comes and instructs martial arts for us. Then the next section is all of our rental information and some interesting highlights. Patterson Park Community Center in 2015, their rental revenues was $86,000. Sportscom was $34,000. That is just from renting the venue out for people who may want to host private parties or business meetings. Then we also have numbers on the facility visitors. As Lanny says, when you add up the people participating in a program, the people who are just showing up at our parks and facilities, that number is quite large. Our athletics fields brought in almost $131,000 in rental revenue. Then we have information on our financial aid. Last year we gave out $389,000 in financial aid to those who meet those requirements, who need assistance. Some of that is they get free or they get reduced admission. Then we have a section on our budget, which is the comparison charts. Since the annual report is a calendar year, but our budget is a fiscal year, so we kind of just show the two side by side. Then we have pages 30 through 33 lists all of the programs that we do in-house and the number of people that participated in those programs. And this year we broke it down by the divisions rather than how frequently the program was offered. So you can see what youth development does or our aquatics division. It kind of gives you a snapshot of each of those divisions. And we had 426,000 people that participate in our in-house programs. Then there's a section in there that outlines the renovations at Sportscom, the new Adams Tennis Facility Complex, Bradley, as Lanny had mentioned, and the green initiatives. We started a recycling program this year that we're trying to encourage participants to recycle when they're using our parks and facilities. So that's the basic highlights of what you can find in this report. I will also make this available on our website so that anybody who's interested in reading the annual report can just go to our website and download it and take their time. There's a lot of information to read through. Any questions for me?
It's great. Great job.
Thank
you. Any questions for Becky regarding the report?
Becky, in compiling this report, I noticed we've got a section here referred to as the Gateway Island. I'm not even sure I want to know the answer to this question, but do we have any idea how much money we spent last year trying to address sinkhole problems with that particular project?
That would be an Angela question.
It would be done through the city's engineering department and water and sewer department, so it would be something that we would need to work through them to follow up and get back with you on.
Okay.
But that isn't actually not funded through our department, so I couldn't give a good answer.
I'm not sure I want to know either. But and currently we're back in the same situation. I was out there the other day, and water was funneling down through a hole. How much effect is that having on our ability to rent this piece of property for use? Because, I mean, to be honest with you, it's not very attractive right now. And if I were having a wedding reception, wouldn't be at the top of my list, to be honest.
It does have an effect. If I could, if you'd like, I can put together some different numbers of our rentals, of our refunds, and provide more of a report back to you on that question.
Yeah, I think we're very near the point that we need to have a discussion on what the future of this particular park in Murfreesboro, whether it needs to be turned into an amphitheater or whether it needs to be turned into a, you know, but I think I'm beyond the point now that I believe that there's a fix to sealing that pond. I've seen thousands and thousands, and I think well over the $1 million mark now, of money that has been poured into holes out there trying to resolve an issue that may be unresolvable. So I think it's time for us to have some serious conversation on what the future use of that property might be.
If you could, we can follow up with city administration and get back with you. Yes, sir.
Please. Thank you.
Any other questions about the annual report? Great work, Becky. It's really nice.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. We are going to move on to our upcoming events, and I'm going to try to move through them as quickly as possible. Tomorrow, Thursday, July 14th. Well, actually, we're going to start with today. Today we have our Flick and Float, which is at Borough Beach Sports Comms Outdoor Pool. That the doors open at 7 o'clock, and the movie starts at 8:30. And it is premium admission for that, but we encourage everybody to come on out to the pool tonight. Bring a lawn chair, blanket, a floaty for the pool, and you can either watch poolside or from the water. And that is tonight at Borough Beach. And then tomorrow, Thursday, July 14th, we have our last splash out. That will be at Old Fort Park, Pavilion Number 1. It is from 1:30 to 3 o'clock, and that is where the Murfreesboro Fire and Rescue Department comes out with their fire trucks, and they use the hose, and they spray the water up in the air, and the kids just kind of run through it and have a great time getting soaked. So tomorrow is our last splash out for this summer. And then this Friday, which is July 15th, in honor of National Park and Recreation Month, we have a Gateway Island and Trail, the Island Fun Run, from 7 to 8, and we will have music and some giveaways, so we encourage people to just come on out and check out the trail that runs out there at Gateway Island, starting at 7 p.m. this Friday. Then on Saturday, August 6th, there will be the Back to School Bash in partnership with the Murfreesboro City Schools. That will be held at Cannonsburg Village from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. It is free for all of those who would like to attend. They'll have music, games, giveaways, and much more on Saturday, August 6th. And then we will have a free summer concert, and the band is called Grizzly Goat, and it is for all ages on Friday, August 12th from 6 to 8 p.m. It's free to attend, and that will be held at Pavilion Number 7 in Barfield Crescent Park. On Saturday, August 20th, we will have Wild Arts Day. That is from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. for all ages at the Wilderness Station at Barfield Crescent Park. They will actually have art by animals, puppet shows, wild animals, story time, and a whole slew of more events. So join us Saturday, August 20th at the Wilderness Station. And then Cannonsburg will have their community yard sale on Saturday, August 27th. From 7 a.m. to noon, but we are encouraging anybody who would like to have a table
to contact Cannonsburg now to get their booth space reserved. It is $10 per booth space. And for information on all of our events and programs, they can check out our website at murfreesborotn.gov/parks or our Facebook pages as well. Any questions?
Any questions for Becky about these or any other upcoming events? A lot going on, as always.
Thank you.
Thanks, Becky. That concludes new business. Does anybody have any other business?
I just have a comment. Our next meeting will be when we're really cranking up school. We're getting ready to crank up school now, so I'm not sure what my attendance will be at that next meeting. I just want to take this opportunity to thank Parks and Rec for their ongoing partnership. It's extremely strong with the city schools, so thank you, Lanny, for your leadership and for what you've done for the children and families and what we'll continue to work together with Parks and Rec to do in the future.
Thank you.
And thank what you guys are doing, Linda, because I mean, I'll echo that sentiment. I think the relationship between Parks and Rec and the schools is as good as I've ever seen it. I've got one other piece of business that I wish I didn't have to share today. Some of you are aware, others maybe not, but I wanted to, before it became fully public information, which is already out on the D&J website, Lanny, so our fearless leader for the past 28 years has announced that he will be retiring from his post as director on August 12th. So we have him for one more meeting. Hopefully we'll be able to line up some little party for that, right, Mitzi? we'll give him some lavish gifts. But
I can't wait.
Yeah, I bet you can't wait. Lanny, you'll be missed. I'm excited for you. You will be deeply missed by Parks and Rec. And the city as all. Well.
We have a tour following this. Who's going? Gosh. Okay. All but D.
I cannot make it.
I'll take you on a private one. We'll reminisce while we do that.
I got 20 plus years. I'm reminiscing today.
I think Angela has his transportation.
Yes, we have a fearless driver sitting in the back in green.
Wow. I am really glad I can't go.
Okay, second question. Now, how many's going?
Who's going?
If we can meet on the lower level, the senior center has graciously loaned us their transportation. So the smaller senior center bus is on the lower blue level. Our itinerary includes six sites as planned, but you guys can guide us, and we'll also watch the clock on that also, or if there's anywhere else that we need to go along the way. But what we have planned for you is a stop by the North Murfreesboro Greenway that is under construction. We're going to look on both sides at Walter Hill Park, and then also at the Coleman Farm property to see how that's coming along. It is a beautiful site, and it is coming along great. We didn't have enough hard hats and vests to share for the crowd, but so we'll do that stop just from the vehicle, but you'll be able to really see how nice that's going to be. We're going to go see the Jordan Farm soccer facility, go by Siegel, stop by the Miracle Field and see how that is coming. Take a look at the McDonald property, which we want to talk about West Park on that site. And then finish our tour over at the Bradley Academy Museum.
All right.
Good stuff. We're kind of seeing north.
Mm-hmm. All right. There's no other business to come before the commission. We stand adjourned.